so much for coming to this evening's performance of very interesting Brahms pieces. The first piece you heard was very late Brahms. Towards the end of his life, after he retired, he basically heard Richard Mühlfeld playing the clarinet, and he says, I have to write something for this instrument. So he wrote a whole bunch of pieces, clarinet quintet, this piano trio, and two sonatas for the clarinet, right at the end of his life when he was really finished doing all compositions. With this piece, it has a very interesting history. This is an opus 8, if you look in your program, which is a very early opus piano trio for violin, cello, and piano, very typical format for what he composed and what chamber music is all about. However, many years later, he really did not like what he did with this particular piece, and as a mature composer, he revised. One of the things about Brahms is very interesting. He really left us very little amount of music, and the reason for that is because if he didn't like something, he absolutely destroyed it, unlike other composers who put it on the shelf, and we find it, and we get to play it. It might be young compositions, not something good. This was something very different. The interesting thing is we have two versions of this Opus 8 trio. We have the original version, which he wrote, and we have the new revised version. The revised version is what you will hear now, which is actually very mature Brahms in many respects. It's very interesting to hear the early piece and really even perform it because you can hear the struggles, what Brahms had with composition, what he tried to do, and how to figure out some things did not work as a young composer, which he really fixed by the time he got to the late version. It's a really large scale piece. The first movement is one of the longest first movements of a lot of piano trios. It's close to 15 minutes long. But it has one of the most glorious melodies, which starts with the piano, then takes over by the cello, and then the violin, and everybody plays together. So please listen to the first movement. It's very, very important. He takes a very interesting short scherzo in the second movement, and then he gives us one of the most cerebral slow movements. It sort of time stops, and it's extremely beautiful, and really you sort of have to sit back and just close your eyes and just let this music take hold. By the time it then finishes, the last movement is really ends with a punch. Now, another interesting thing about this particular trio, and that is the trio is listed as trio in B major. However, it concludes in B minor, and it is very rare in music world, in compositions, where pieces begin in major key and transverse into a minor key. We have the other one all the time, from minor key to major. The prime example, of course, is the Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, which starts in C minor and then transforms into C major by the time it gets to the last movement, and it's very heroic. And many pieces like this will do this. There are a few compositions that do this other thing. Primarily, those of you that might know the Mendelssohn's Italian Symphony, that starts in a major key very happily when he arrives in Italy, when Mendelssohn composed, and then by the time he gets to the last movement, he writes this really wicked tarantella for the orchestra in minor key, which basically means after you get bitten by a tarantula, you're supposed to jump around like a fiend to try to get the poison out of your system. So this particular piece, again, has this trajectory from a very happy and lyrical B major into B minor, which is, again, a very strange key. Some of the most serious compositions were written in the key of B minor. The B minor Mass comes to mind of Bach, and then, of course, the B minor Liszt Sonata, and other works as well. So it's a really wonderful piece. It's a pleasure for us to play. We hope you enjoy it.
Thank you. Thank you.